the I am Pope. So you see what I mean? When you talk about potency, you have to say so. See, there's a usage in language, even in, not just in the American Heritage Dictionary, which very, in a very good way, presents the English language and its usage in the United States. There is a usage in theological talk, in theological speak. And according to the usage of all the past centuries, you have to say when something is only such in potency. See, I'm in potency, I am in act, in actu in Latin, in act, I am a priest, I am a man, and in potency, I am a natural father of children. Won't happen to me, rest assured, I mean, I'll try my best. But in potency, I'm also Pope. Now, you would call a psychiatrist if I was going to insist that I am Pope, right? He says that all men are saved. He's pronouncing heresy according to the usage of language. And this brings us to tradition and the duties and the rights of a Pope, which I have to explain before I explain tradition.
All right, so that was a quick clip. You know, maybe what we'll do is we'll come back to a little bit, even a deeper definition of potency and act. But, you know, what we can see is, you know, by Pope Francis not clearly explaining that, you know, it's only potentially everyone saved by the blood of Christ. Actually, not everyone is. And we know that because, you know, St. Gregory says, you know, many attain to the faith, but few to the heavenly kingdom. We have St. Anselm saying that there are few who are saved. You know, if we look just at the figures in the Old Testament, if you look at Noah's Ark, you know, the entire world was covered by the deluge. Only 8 people were saved in the Ark, which St. Peter says the Ark was a figure of the church. But then you have St. Augustine further explaining that, and I'll quote from him now, quote, "And these 8 people who were saved signify that very few Christians are saved, because there are very few who sincerely renounce the world, and those who renounce it only in words do not belong to the mystery represented by that ark." End quote. So here, St. Augustine is talking about Catholics, Christians, not being signified by the 8 that are in the ark that were saved, and very few, because obviously very few renounce the world, as the saint said. So
sure.
how can we possibly assume that those who don't believe in God and then arguably are living in a constant state of sin, how can we possibly say that they're all saved when, you know, obviously, again, going back to the psalmist, you know, he's saying the fool says in his heart there is no God. I mean, that's the Holy Spirit speaking through David. So, you know, there's certainly a disconnect here. That being said, I think we've made a pretty good point here that, you know, from the saints, from the dogmatic teachings of the church, that, and from Christ's words himself in the scriptures, that in fact not everyone is saved. And perhaps we'll, in a future episode, we'll cover this in greater detail. Now, Eric, how, you know, we've seen two different views, okay? So we can say one is the traditional view, right? The traditional understanding, the traditional faith of what has always been held, always in the same sense, in the same understanding, same explanation as the First Vatican Council dogmatically described or defined tradition. And,
sure.
then we see this other, this new explanation of salvation. You know, tradition saying there's no salvation outside the Catholic Church. And then, you know, the Church of the quote-unquote New Advent, that the term that John Paul II used, saying that there is salvation outside the Church. Could you maybe explain some of that? What is tradition? What does it mean to be Catholic? And some of those distinctions?
Sure. If I may backtrack for a second, just going along the modernist thought process here in terms of, I know in the article it talks about, and I know the post-conciliar popes always harp on this created, man is created in the likeness and image of God. Well, this is correct, but they do not hold the traditional sense because they literally take out the notion of original sin. Okay, and they have a false perception of human dignity, just as Pope St. Pius the 10th taught concerning the modernists, and how it's very deceptive that when we say all men are redeemed, it is attached to this perverse notion that doesn't take into the equation for original justice, meaning in the beginning with Adam and Eve, of course, they were born into original justice, but through the fall, okay, all men now are born into original sin, and we can see through their writings that we do not see this being taught or implied, and this is literally what they believe. So when they say all men are redeemed, there truly is no need for conversion in their thought process, and we can see this over and over again. And hopefully we'll be able to touch on this more in depth with actual quotes from Pope John Paul II. But this notion of coexistence and tolerance, okay, which are Freemasonic principles and tenets, okay, and there truly is no need for conversion in the conciliar church because all men are redeemed, of course, right?
Right, right.
And they
haven't
explained it in the traditional sense, which is misleading, which brings to mind here a few quotes from Pope St. Pius X concerning tolerance, because we see this constantly in the writings of the conciliar church, where they are promoting this social democracy rather than the social kingship of Christ. And I have here, let us see here, from our apostolic mandate from Pope St. Pius X, he clearly teaches, when he states, Catholic doctrine tells us that the primary duty of charity does not lie in the toleration of false ideas. Again, so the notion of meeting someone in the middle is not a sufficient answer for a Catholic. It is, of course, to love those who are outside the church and outside the true fold, at the very roots, in the heart. But it is they who must assent to truth. It is they who must, by heart, assent to Catholic teaching. And so also, I have another quote here. It's very, very powerful. Pope St. Pius X states, further, while Jesus was kind to sinners and to those who went astray, he did not respect their false ideas, however sincere they may have appeared. He loved them all, but he instructed them in order to convert and save them. And that is the key. Okay, and this is not being taught in the conciliar church.
No.
He further continues, whilst he called himself in order to comfort them, those who toiled and suffered, it was not to preach to them the jealousy of a chimerical equality. And this is what we see coming through Vatican II, is this breaking down of the various working classes to promote this pseudo-equality. And it is, again, a Masonic principle, and we know that this runs contrary to traditional teaching. So we just have to keep that in mind for those who do not understand that there's the traditional sense, and then there is this new sense, new church sense,
right,
of what it is to be inside the church. And I know we talked about this briefly earlier in the day, concerning this false notion of partial communion,
right,
which is another novelty nowhere to be found in tradition, wherein the Catholic Church clearly teaches that you must hold the faith whole and inviolate.
Right, that's the Athanasian Creed, right?
Correct, and also in James 2:10, where clearly Apostle James speaks that if you depart from one aspect of the law, you're not considered a part of the law. Well, according to the modernists of the conciliar church, you can still have partial communion with truth. And I always say this jokingly with a modernist. I ask them, how can a devil have 1 foot in heaven and 1 foot in hell. It's not a possibility.
Right. You're either on the ark or you're outside the ark. I don't remember hearing someone hanging onto the ark and being saved. I mean, it is ridiculous. And, you know, there's some people may not be familiar with this. You know, in 1993, in the quote-unquote dialogue with the Orthodox churches, there was what's called the Balaman Agreement. Now, in paragraph 30 of that agreement, what they state in it is that basically we need to pass, and I'll quote from it.